time, I don't think I knew much about what Mike is now describing in detail. My own participation in this was on April 23rd. Somebody told me that there was a demonstration on campus. I went to the campus and didn't leave the campus until the 30th. I slept in Philosophy Hall. And because of Walter Metzger and Manny Wallerstein and some others on ad hoc faculty who were absolutely brilliant and my heroes as my teachers in the college, I stuck around for one of the most amazing experiences you could ever have. I joined the SRU research staff in the summer, and John Toms here is one of the founders of SRU, coming out of the strike committee, Lucille Roussain. Who else is here from SRU? And of course, my buddy. Now, Steve Silverblatt and I, the one experience I had with Mike back then, which led me to the notion that he was both brilliant and charming, was that he came over to our office in Teachers College. It's one of the moments of my life. And we had our feet up on the chair, and it became obvious to me that Mike was basically taking a look to see whether or not he was going to have any trouble doing what he wanted to do. And having met Steve, who was very brilliant, and myself, who I thought was somewhat savvy on politics since I was teaching in the college and SIA at the time, it became really clear from an early point that the inheritors of the mantle of the leadership of this university was going to pass from Grayson Kirk and the patrician, waspy, somewhat anti-Semitic, but not even, when I got to the college in 62, it wasn't anti-Semitic anymore. But it was anti-Semitic for many years. And forget about blacks. But the bottom line is that Mike was going to inherit the universe, and Mike actually did. So I really would like to throw out that I think you underrepresented yourself, as usual, in a self-effacing way. Because there was a meeting of the ad hoc faculty negotiating committee with Alan Weston as chairman, who happens to be a lawyer, as is Mike. And Mike came in and essentially derailed the ad hoc faculty negotiating committee. So from a politics and a power perspective, I think one of the interesting things about the University Senate, it is that the faculty and senior faculty, and all of the names he mentioned, by the way, in the first instance, Eli Ginsberg, Luckenberg, Nagel, Hofstadter, if you will, there was a real group of them who would be meeting during the time of this mess and counseling behind the scenes about what to do. And none of us knew what they were counseling each other about what to do. And so one of the interesting things today might be for Ron Breslow, who was around then, he may know, who had the idea of the University Senate first? Where did it come from? Because during the summer of 68, myself, Nigel Pandith, and other members of SRU went around and interviewed practically everybody on this campus about what to do on the internal side of this university. And one of the key issues of the internal side of this university was the powerlessness of the students, not to mention that the faculty were upset that they weren't being listened to. The students essentially were completely disempowered. There wasn't a student government in the college at that time. So, one of the key issues that comes up here is who has the power, how do they use it, when do they use it, and are they smart about using it? And one of the key issues in 68 was that Kirk really got stupid. And Truman, unfortunately, who was going to be president of the university, lost it all. So this was a very emotional, passionate, amazing time. I'll say a couple of things more about some of the issues on the table here, I think. I think that SRU, and I commend SRU, I did not start SRU. I worked at SRU in research, and then I think Steve Silverblatt and I inherited it in the fall. But the bottom line is that I think that we were among the only people on campus who were actively opposing any violence by anybody. Number one, the students went in the buildings and occupied the buildings and committed a bunch of acts that were really heinous, among other things. Number two, the administration always had the option of calling the police. Those of you who remember Political Science 1, remember that the state has the monopoly on the use of violence. So the bottom line was the cops. And we opposed the police on this campus from day one in the IHOP Faculty Negotiating Committee. And I will say that a number of the folks, just to make this interesting, Tom, a number of the folks that Mike refers to, like Eli Ginsberg, Luckenberg, Nagel, and some others, nobody heard a word from them about whether or not police should come on this campus while they were maybe doing some negotiating behind the scenes. And Bob Belknap's back there, who's another major figure of this time and might have something to say about these things too. So we opposed the violence, and once the violence occurred, then this whole thing came, which I find a little bit boring now 40 years later, but I'll read it for you. And that is, there needs to be some constructive rebuilding of our immediate context at Columbia. Now, what did that mean? Ready for this? University reform, institutional reform, governance of the university change, reorganizing the university, basic structure of the university changes, and structural reorganization. Well, you know, as a political scientist, I took one look at the trustees, and then I met my friend Mike, and I said, no way. I said, what's going to happen around here is some very mild form of some moderate reforms, and then we're going to hopefully have some smarter people around. One of them I wanted to have here today from Washington State was Ted Van Dyke. Ted Van Dyke had lost the election with Humphrey. And Humphrey, if you recall, lost the election in Illinois in the last minute. So it was really closer than you think. But Ted Van Dyke was hired by the university sort of like smooth things over. And he was a smoother. And he would meet with Steve and I and others from SRU and basically tell us, you know, Cordier is going to be cool, everything's going to be fine, we're going to isolate the SDS guys, don't worry about anything, and we're going to really respond to your grievances and your needs. Well, does the University Senate today represent a representation of what students can have as a participation and power in a university appropriately? Is the Senate today functioning in a way that really deals with questions the university is facing, such as Manhattanville or anything else you want to bring up? Is the Senate having an active role in advisory? And also, since Mike was president of the university for 13 years, right, 13? It would be very interesting to hear from Mike how he regarded the University Senate during his tenure, since he established it. I would love to know what Mike thought of his creation. John Toms here, who is one of the beautiful people of the SRU group that started it, wrote that he wanted to see a new community at Columbia. He said he wanted us to speak the truth. And he said something which I like: human beings gathered together in the same room would do well to pay attention to one another. I've been at Columbia since 1962. I've been a student, a faculty member. I helped found Project Global Discovery and other things. I've never found Columbia to be a place where it's really an open dialogue and where you really know what's going on, unless you know somebody. And as we know in this world, knowing somebody is a very big key to knowing what the hell's going on. So the idea that my friend Robert Paul Wolff, the philosopher, said in 68, wish this thing was higher, you know, like bending all the time.
We hear you.
Thank you. Yeah. I don't know. Okay. Boy, that's... Robert Paul Wolff. I don't know, how many of you remember Robert Paul Wolff's philosophy? Brilliant, brilliant man. He came up to me after the bust, and I was taking somebody to the hospital and all that, and he said to me, you know, he said, and you know that twitch he had, he said, the trustees are never, ever going to let this place really change. And one of the questions about Columbia University is, has it really changed in any fundamental way since that time, internally? And I think the answer to that really is an interesting one. I think a lot of good things actually have occurred around here, and that might be something to reflect upon about whether the Senate has had some influence in making Columbia more responsive, or we know, much smarter, and much more attuned to the world in which it's now living. I think I'll stop with that, and thank you very, very much. It's a real pleasure to be here, and I will say one other thing quick. The SRU never, ever wanted a Senate with 62 faculty, 24 students, 6 research folks, 2 administrative staff. The bottom line was, I think the proposal was that we have equal power, and that is a very good thing to debate sometime, but the idea of 62 faculty, 24 students, et cetera.